right, Mr. Giroux.
Okay, let's try and run it through a few pages of notes here, or chalkboard notes, for I'm an attempt to help you understand how to set up simulations in statistics and give you an idea of how they're used. We're not going to do hardly any examples. As you know from these videos, it's mainly basically like a conceptual set of notes, but there'll be a couple of examples thrown in. Okay, still trying to get over cold, so excuse the throat here. Simulations. They help to answer very complex or costly questions about the probability of certain events, given that we know or accept some probabilities about another real event. As an example, what I'm talking about here, we can find the probability of getting heads 4 times in a row when we flip a coin 10 times. And that actually is surprisingly, well, it's not super likely, like 90% chance, but it is higher than you would think. If we accept the chance for heads as being 50%. Now, if you wanted to do the simulation with your calculator, you would just simply do rand int 0, 1, the minimum number you want to create randomly, and the maximum number you want to create randomly, and you want to look at 10 numbers to represent those simulation of 10 flips. And you can store those in the list 1, and then just scroll through those numbers, and you don't really have to store them. It's only 10 numbers, and it's just zeros and ones, so that you could just look left and right on your calculator screen and probably scroll back and forth and see if you have a run of at least four outcomes in that, you know, simulation of 10 flips. Now, that one simulation will not even be close to being able to answer your question. You wouldn't flip a coin once and go, "I got heads!" So the chance of heads is 100%. No, you have to flip that coin many times before you could actually say that, you know, "I've observed this coin flip a couple hundred times, and I believe the chance of heads is blank." Well, if you want to answer this question with a simulation, you will not enter this into your calculator once and analyze whether you got a success or failure. You'll repeat that process. Well, in a textbook, you could just say repeat it 20 times just to illustrate that you understand the concept. But in real life, you might want to run that simulation a couple hundred times, or maybe even more, to get a very accurate estimation of that actual answer that you did with just a simulation, as opposed to doing some kind of real mathematical equation. Okay. Oh, and by the way, this command is under math probability in your calculator. What simulations cannot do is actually find out if that coin is fair. We had to assume that it was 50-50. It cannot find out what percent of manufactured pieces in a factory are actually defective. Now, if you assume that maybe 1% is defective, then you can answer questions like, what's the probability in a batch of 20 I get more than 3 defective ones? But you'd have to assume that you know that 1% are defective. But if you wanted to find out what percent were defective, that would have to go through observation, not a simulation. Or, you know, what percent of students love my class? Now, of course, my opinion must be everybody, but I'm sure that's not really the case. All right, so a little intro to simulations. Let's keep this introduction going. Woo! Bam. Okie dokie. Okay, we can find out the probability of two people in a room sharing the same birthday. That's actually a very complex question. When you run a simulation, it's off the screen now, but the very first step of simulations is to assign numerical values, if that's what you're going to randomly generate. Assign numerical values, or whatever values you're going to randomly generate, to represent real events in the population. So the 0 up there for heads and 1 for tails was, of course, to let that 0 and 1 represent the real outcome of heads or tails. Now, that simple 0 and 1 is not going to fly, not going to work, if we don't have a 50-50 percent likelihood. If it was 40% tails and 60% heads, then I might want to say that 1 through 40 represents a heads. Did I just get that backwards? And 41 to 100 would represent tails. Like, you would actually have to have a more complicated number assignment for those real-life events. So if I want to run a simulation to find out the probability that 30 people in a room, that two of those 30 people share the same birthday, not birth year, just, you know, birthday like October 17th or October 30th or January 1st or whatever. Well, then I let the number assignments of 1 through 365 be the random numbers that I'm going to generate, and let those be the day of the year. You know, I know there's leap year and the whole quarter thing, but, you know, it's basically 365 days in a year. So I could do rand int 1 to 365, generate 30 numbers to represent my 30 people in a room. Now that's a lot of numbers with a lot of spread. And again, this is under math probability. So I might want to store those numbers in a list, and this colon command, or this symbol, is above the decimal on your TI-83 or TI-84, and honestly, I'm not sure where it is on an Inspire yet. I should. It might be in the same place, but probably not. And then put in a second command of sort ascending list 1, or you could do descending. This is under the list command of your calculator. If you do second stat, you go into the list command and choose, I don't know if it's ops or math, but you can find this in there. So generate your numbers, 1 to 365, generate 30, store them in a list, sort them out. You can do all that in one single step. And the sorting will be nice because I don't care about the sequence of events. Not like the previous example where I wanted to find the chance of a run of 4 heads out of 10. I would definitely not want to sort that data because I would not be able to analyze if there was a run of 4 outcomes or more. But I could sort them here and just scroll down list 1 and see if there's a repeat number. You'll be surprised how high that probability is. It's actually about 50-50 in a room of 23. So if you're in a room with more than 23 people and you want to win, maybe gamble a little bit, go, hey, I bet there's two people in this room that have the same birthday. And if there's, I think it's more than 23, the chances start to come into the favor of there is probably two people with the same birthday. It's more than 50%. Okay, in statistics, we have three ways of analyzing the probability of an event, such as flipping a coin and getting 4 heads in a row, or seeing if the probability of two people having the same birthday, or what percent of the population go to church or shop at a store or have a certain political opinion. We can estimate the probability of an event by doing an actual observation. This is called an empirical probability, but the definition of empirical is in a set of later notes. We can estimate the probability of an event by observing the random phenomenon many times and calculating the relative frequency. The random phenomenon could be flipping a coin, it could be asking people what their birthdays are, assuming those people are randomly chosen, randomly choosing people and ask them a political question, something like that. Your random phenomenon many times and calculating the relative frequency. Hey, I flipped this coin 500 times and my chance, and I got heads 47% of the time, so I estimate the chance of this coin landing heads is 47%. It is only 500 observations or whatever that number is I just said, so I know it's not exactly right, but it's about correct. And the larger your sample is, the larger your trial is, the closer you will be, you should be, to the actual true probability. But now I'm getting into variability and sample size, and I'm kind of getting off topic a little bit because most of this section I want to talk about is about simulation. So moving on, develop a probability model and use it to calculate a theoretical answer. Okay, this is more like your discrete random variable, which we haven't studied yet, so I'm going to move on from that, but we will be talking about this very, very shortly in my book will be chapter 7, discrete random variables and setting up a probability model. And actually, I'll be setting up a probability model with you when we talk about the very next section of notes, which will be aired tomorrow. And of course, if you're on the internet, there is no air date. It's whenever you play it, whatever. And then finally, start with a model that in some fashion reflects the truth about the random event, and then develop a plan for simulating the number of repetitions of the practice. And now this is what we're talking about, simulations. Assign numerical values, if that's what you're randomly generating, to real life events, and make sure that those number assignments match the probability of that event occurring. If something has a 67% probability, I'm going to say values 1 to 67 is a success, and 68 to 100 is not a success. If I'm just flipping a coin, however, like the previous example, well, that's 50-50, so I can just say 0 is heads and 1 is tails, because that's a 50-50 outcome. Two possibilities total, 0 heads, 1 tails, 50-50. Ah, great. And then you generate those numbers, like your birthday situation here, and you repeat that simulation many, many times, law of large numbers. I don't believe I've thoroughly covered that yet, but it will be coming up on the next set of notes, or you can look it up in your textbook. And then you go, well, you know, based on my number of simulations, the probability of this event is blank. So this would be, if I were to run this in my calculator, that would be one simulation. I would record whether there was two birthdays shared or not, since that's what the question is about. And then I would repeat that many, many times, maybe, you know, just for textbook use, 20, 30 times. And then based on those 30 observations, estimate the probability of two people in a room having the same birthday out of 30. All right, one more page of notes. I'm probably getting close on time, so moving on.
Yes, I only have about 3.5 minutes left, so I better talk quickly.
Okay, trials, the number of times you run a simulation. We're using the law of large numbers to estimate the probability of an event, so we must run many, many trials. If you look in your statistics books, you'll probably find a diagram about tracking the probability of heads over many, many trials. It was an actual experiment run, and it actually did not really come close to a consistent 50% until close to 1,000 trials were run. Even 300-400 trials came up with a probability of heads of like 45 or 40, you know, like in the 40 or 50s percent range, like down to 42 or maybe up to 57%, something like that. So many, many trials before the law of large numbers kicks in. Think about the lottery. You know, you can spend a dollar and win hundreds of millions of dollars, but that state knows, if you live in a state with a lottery, that if they, you know, they sell millions, if not, I can't even imagine how many tickets they sell. They know, based on the law of large numbers, they're going to make a certain average amount per ticket sold, even though some people spend a buck and win millions. Independence. One outcome does not influence another. Such as rolling a die and getting a 3 does not mean that when you pick that die up, the next time you roll it, it's a piece of, I don't know what it's made out of, plastic. It's not going to know it just landed on 3. It's going to be random the next time. If you flip a coin 8 times in a row, you are not you flip it 8 times in a row and you get heads 8 times in a row. That coin is not going, hey man, I better land on tails soon. I just landed on heads 8 times. That next trial is going to be independent. We will be talking about independent trials and independent events. There is a little bit of a difference, and right now I'm just referring to the trials being independent. Getting a random number from a calculator, we have randint, randbin, and randnorm. Randnorm is when you want to randomly generate numbers out of a theoretical normal distribution. Randbin is when we are simulating an event that only has two outcomes, but all we care about is not the sequence of those outcomes, but the number of successes out of a certain number of trials. So, how many times do you want to do something? Like, let's take free throws. You want to make 20 free throws? What's your chance of success? And then how many times do you want to run the simulation? If you put a 1 here, then you put in like randbin 20, maybe I make 60% of my free throws. I might get a number of like 12. And that number of 12 would be the number of successes out of my n number of trials, or the size of my simulation, and then how many simulations I want to run. Now, you'll notice with the previous two examples, I referenced randint. That works for an event that has more than just two outcomes, and because you can store them in a list, you can analyze the sequence of that random behavior. And then summary statement, based on my blank number of simulations, the estimated probability of an event is blank. I'm out of time. I'm Mr. True. Go read your book. Go do your homework. Thank you very, very much for watching my videos. I'm out.